I'd like to start off by telling you a story. It's about a woman named Barbara. Now, unfortunately for Barbara, when she was young, unhealthy habits were modeled at home. And several of her close relatives struggled with a very specific type of disorder. As Barbara got older, she realized that exposure to a certain type of substance was highly rewarding for her, and she began actively seeking it out and consuming it without experiencing really any negative consequences. Over time, though, Barbara began to experience the negative health effects associated with taking the substance for a long period of time. She had intense cravings. She began to struggle with depression. And even though she had tried to reduce her intake several times, she had been unsuccessful each time. Now, I'm sure you all have an idea of what it is that Barbara is struggling with, and if you had guessed addiction, then you would be correct. Barbara's not alone in this. 1 in 5 Canadians will meet the criteria for substance use disorder at some point in their lifetime. I want you to think about this. I want you to look to the two people on your right-hand side, and then the two people on your left-hand side. Statistically speaking, this means that one of you will meet the criteria for substance use disorder at some point in your lifetime. 4 in 10 Canadians will meet the criteria for addiction to tobacco products. 2 in 10 Canadians will meet the criteria for addiction to alcohol. And 6 in 100, about 6% of the population, will meet the criteria for addiction to cannabis and other illicit substances. The social cost of this, according to a 2006 study, was approximately $39.8 billion each year. This means that it costs just over $1,200 to every man, woman, and child in Canada. And this includes both direct costs like the cost of healthcare and law enforcement, and indirect costs like lost productivity at work. Now, Barbara's specific addiction will cost Canadians approximately $4.5 billion each year. Now, some of you may have an idea of what the substance Barbara is addicted to is. Some of you might be guessing tobacco. Some of you might be thinking alcohol. Some of you might be thinking something a little harder, like cocaine or heroin. In actuality, Barbara isn't addicted to any of these substances. Barbara is addicted to food. Now, some of you might be surprised by that statement, and some of you might not disagree, or may disagree with that statement. And in fact, the controversy surrounding food addiction has been waging for the better part of the past 10 years on two fronts. The first is what I like to call the social media war. On one side, you have individuals that claim to suffer from food addiction and provide anecdotal evidence of their own experiences and the experiences of the people that they know. And on the other side is you have individuals that claim that the words food addiction are simply a cover, an excuse, for developing obesity or for having low self-control. The other front on which this controversy is waged is in the scientific one. 10 years ago, health scientists started saying, look, we've got people coming to us and they are showing hallmark features of addiction. They are showing tolerance. They're showing withdrawal. They're showing impulse control issues. And on the other side, you had individuals that studied the sort of classic drugs of abuse, like cocaine and like heroin, who said that food could not be classified in the same way as those drugs and that the neurobiological things that happen when someone becomes addicted aren't present in individuals that claim to suffer from food addiction. Now, this is where I came in. This is when I began to be interested in research, and I had been exposed to this controversy in social media, and I'd been exposed to it in the scientific field, and I was really interested. So when I started my research, I started with a very simple question. And that question was, can the rewarding properties of food produce addiction? Now, one of the hallmark features of addiction is compulsion. And if you look up the definition of compulsion in the dictionary, it is the irresistible urge to behave in a way that runs contrary to your express conscious wishes. In addiction, we see this present as individuals that are unable to stop themselves from consuming a substance, even if they no longer wish to, and even if they no longer derive any enjoyment from doing so. So I went back to my original question, can the rewarding properties of food produce addiction? And I modified it to, can the rewarding properties of food produce compulsion, this hallmark feature of addiction? Now, to do this, I used an already established model. And I exposed animals, rats specifically, to a substance that is commonly found in food and also happens to be highly rewarding. And that substance is refined white sugar. And I exposed these animals to a concentration that is commonly found in sweetened beverages. So I used a 10% concentration, and for comparison, the average can of pop has about 11%. And I exposed these animals to this concentration of sugar for 12 hours a day, every day, for about a month. And some very interesting things happened. The first is that they began to binge. They were consuming about 5% of their body weight in the first hour every time they had access to the sugar. Now, for comparison, you can think of someone my size and my body weight drinking about 3 liters of pop, or eating 1/3 of a kilo of sugar in 1 hour. They also heavily escalated their intake over time. By the end, in a 12-hour period, they were consuming roughly 1/5 of their body weight, which again, for comparison, is someone like me consuming 13 liters of pop, or 1.3 kilos of refined white sugar. Imagine drinking this, or eating this every day. So this was really shocking to me. But what I was interested in was whether exposure to this amount of sugar could produce compulsion. Now, unfortunately, you can't ask an animal, are you addicted to something? You can't ask an animal, are you compulsive? So I had to put them in an evolutionarily relevant situation, one that pit their instinctual mechanism for avoiding danger versus this learned behavior to seek out and consume sugar. And when I did that, the animals that had been consuming massive amounts of sugar completely overrode this instinctual mechanism in favor of seeking out sugar. And this is something that normal, healthy animals will not do. But what was happening neurobiologically? What was happening in their brains? Well, there are some very specific changes that happen to a brain when it becomes addicted to a substance. And the changes that happen are different depending on the type of brain area that you're looking at. The specific area that I was interested in is implicated in survival-based motivated behaviors. And it happens to sit between two other brain areas that have already been heavily implicated in the development of addiction. The first is the amygdala, which processes emotional and rewarding information, and the other is the striatum, which is responsible for reinforcement-based learning and motor control. Now, this area had actually already been looked at by a colleague of mine. And he was looking at it in animals that self-administered cocaine, classic drug of abuse, over a long period of time. And he was able to show that there's a very unique change that happens to the neurons in this brain area. They respond very differently to dopamine, which is the brain's primary rewarding neurotransmitter, than the neurons do in the brains of animals that had either had no exposure to cocaine or had been exposed to cocaine but weren't self-administering it for a long period of time. Now, when I looked at this brain area in my animals, to my astonishment, I found exactly the same change in their brains as what was happening in animals that were self-administering cocaine. So, What's happening? What does this mean? Well, our brains are highly evolved, adapted organs. And our brains have evolved to seek out rewarding substances and perform rewarding behaviors because in our evolutionary history, that meant survival. Things like having sex, eating good food, avoiding danger. Unfortunately, this highly adapted system, when it's exposed to unnaturally reinforcing substances like drugs, this formerly adaptive process becomes maladaptive. There's this war going on between our evolved biology that pushes us to consume rewarding substances and pushes us to perform rewarding behaviors versus our modern environment, a society in which unnaturally reinforcing substances are plentifully available. This is why we are starting to see addictions to things that are fundamentally new to our modern society. Addictions to things like gambling, to video games, and to food. Now, there's still quite a bit of controversy in the scientific literature about what exactly the properties of food are that can produce addiction. But I think in general, as a society, we need to start thinking about addiction beyond drugs. We need to stop having such a rigid idea of what the substances are that can produce addiction. We need to stop thinking about it as drugs versus other. Because really, any highly rewarding substance or behavior can produce the same behavioral and neurological things that we see in addiction. We need to start thinking of addiction as a very old brain's way of trying to deal with a very new problem. So I want you to do something for me when you leave here today. I want you to just be aware. And when you see hotly debated topics like this one in social media and other spheres, I want you to think, and I want you to question, and I want you to investigate. Because as I found out, addiction doesn't necessarily look like what it used to anymore. Thank you.